Today, our Wisdom Wednesday Lecture Series guest will be David Newton. He is providing a presentation entitled The Economic Impact of Climate Change. David Newton is a native of Mississippi. Here he attended the University of Mississippi, where he received a BBA, a BS, MBA, and PhD degrees. Following military service and education at Ole Miss, he taught at the University of Houston and came to Auburn University in 1974. At AU, he served as an associate professor in the Department of Pharmacy Care Systems, as director of continuing education, and as assistant dean of the School of Pharmacy. He retired in August of 1995 and continues to live in Auburn. Newton's interests in retirement include family, conservation, environment, government, travel, and gardening. His interest in government came into focus when he returned to Ole Miss in the fall of 1962, along with James Meredith, the first African American to attend Ole Miss. The events that followed made him much more aware of social justice, of the importance of citizen action, and of fair, honest, and open government. His interest in conservation and the environment began during the countless hours spent along the bayous and in the woods near the home of his youth in Northwest Mississippi. In retirement, he and his late wife, Ray, traveled extensively, visiting all seven continents, concentrating on natural history. Newton is a member of several national, state, and local environmental organizations and has been a volunteer activist for all of them and in leadership positions for some. For 11 years on behalf of the Alabama Water Watch program at AU, he performed monthly chemical tests at the water in the Sagahatchie Creek in North Auburn. For several years, he chaired the legislative committee of Sierra Club's Alabama chapter. He has also organized numerous classes on the environment for the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute. At AU, he organized his first of several OLLI classes on climate change in spring 2008. Please give a warm welcome to David Newton, our speaker today.
Thank you from everyone. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah. Right. It's good to be here and glad all of you showed up. I see some friends here I've known for a long time. And I'm pleased to be able to chat with you just for a little bit. And I've got some ruled cards in my hand. And I see Gene Hunter in the back. Maybe he can, if you might be interested in asking a question after I get through. And I've got a panel of helpers here to answer questions, okay? But Gene's going to pass out cards if you want one. You might raise your hand. And if you... And I would thank my... I guess you call them my mentors. Gene's a mentor in a way. Birds, gardening, expert. Unparalleled, you might say. Sonny Dawson here down front, and Shandana Mitra is here somewhere, and she's going to be helping with answering of questions. She's an honest-to-goodness climatologist on the staff at AU in geosciences, and Sonny is retired from there, as you probably know, and knows a lot about what's going on planet Earth. I've heard him talk about it, and I see another mentor out here, Bill Deutsch, the water man, and the main water man. Never encountered somebody that knew more about Alabama rivers than Bill. But it's good to be here, and I need to be careful about running my mouth about just whatever comes to mind. So the overview that I mentioned here in the title slide has to do with a kind of an overview of climate change. The opportunities in Alabama insofar as such things as renewable energy and all, there are many. I won't talk about that right now, but there are many opportunities that we could take advantage of if we make the decision to do so. This is a kind of a breakout of what I'm into here. Some things that impact climate change, something about the social and political observations that I've made, and the energy scene, that is, the sources and how we use it and so forth, what the scientists are saying, and what climate change is already doing or has done, and what we see going on a little bit in renewable energy and opportunities in Alabama, as I mentioned earlier. We have a lot of topics here, and obviously we're just kind of going to skate over the top of it. But anyway, let's get underway here. The variables impacting climate change. This chart slide goes back 800,000 years in the deep time, you might call it, on the left side, this being the present on the right. And you'll notice that CO2 concentration in the atmosphere tracks pretty much with temperature globally. And this comes from ice cores in Antarctica. You can go back about 800,000 years in various ways that I won't get into. Maybe Shondana might at some point if she's asked about it. But anyway, it is something that we've known about. That is the influence of climate change, not 800,000 years ago, of course, but in more recent times, back in about the 1800s. And now here it is kind of broken out, and we add sea level in the bottom part of this slide right here. You can see CO2 concentration at the top in green, in the middle global temperature in red, sea level in blue, and they kind of match up a bit. And you'll notice that all of them kind of stay on the graph. But I want you to zero in on what's going on the upper right-hand corner of this graph at the top. CO2 concentration, it's at the highest point that it's been in 800,000 years. And if it keeps on the way it's headed or has headed in recent times, folks, we got a problem. And so we need to, all of us, citizens particularly, and all of us here are, you know, voters or going to be voters and so forth, we need to raise our voices to the people in charge, that is, elected officials. Okay, let's move ahead. This is, in recent times, you see, starts about 1953 and goes to 18. Spring of 18, and it's a concentration, as you can see, of CO2 parts per million in atmosphere, and the measurements made it on Mauna Loa Observatory on the Big Island of Hawaii. It's the southern, it's southeast of the Mauna Kea. Mauna Kea is the one on the Big Island that has all the telescopes on it, and I don't know what else is on Mauna Loa, other than this Scripps program observatory regards concentration of CO2. But notice the zigzag, kind of a sawtooth sort of a thing there. And when I first saw it, I said, that's curious. Well, it has to do with the taking up of CO2 out of the air in the springtime when plants start to grow and they take it up when they are making chlorophyll during the summer or growing season, and then in the winter, the decaying matter, decaying by bacteria and such, on the ground, leaf litter, we'll say, for example, it causes CO2 to be released And so it jumps up and down every year. And it's kind of steady going there. A fellow named Charles Keeling, K-E-E-L-A-I-N-G, I believe is where it's spelled. And he started this in 53. His son has continued it, Ralph, and it's under the auspices of the Scripps Institution in I believe it's in San Diego. But anyway, that's the story on that. And it's you can see it's going up steadily. Okay, next one. As you can see, they're marked in yellow. Well, first, it says this is from the World Meteorological Organization, and the little in yellow there, 20 warmest years on record have been in the past 22 years, with the top four in the past 4 years, and it's kind of concentrated. Well, it follows. If CO2 is going up, temperature go up, and it's this, as you can, well, you recognize the United States. It obscures, it's overlaid over the continent of Antarctica. Antarctica is big. A lot of folks don't appreciate that. It's about half a, well, it, I wouldn't say it's double the size of the U.S., but it's at least one and a half times as big. And that is the 48 contiguous states. And it's some of the ice on Antarctica is 2 miles thick. There is a lot of water in the form of ice that's available to go into the ocean. And we don't want that to happen. But I must point out that particularly down here on the what they call the west side, this is a mountain range right here in Antarctica that's kind of, it's a central sort of a thing that comes over through down. But on this part over here on the west side, it's melting at a fairly significant rate. Why? Well, there's been some warming of the oceans, and the warm currents are eating underneath, well, melting the ice underneath the glaciers. And a lot of these glaciers are held back by seamounts down there and in other places possibly, but particularly in Antarctica. And there's clearly the possibility that some of these glaciers, well, they've already calved off up here on the peninsula. This is where South America's right up in here a little ways. There's been some serious loss of ice on this side of that peninsula in the last few years in separate instances of breaking off. It's an ice shelf for the most part that is out over the water and kind of floating, but held back a bit, not necessarily by a seamount, but just there's not enough pressure to push it down. But anyway, that's kind of the picture of where we are regards to Antarctica. And this is jumping back in time a little bit, but some people raise questions. Well, climate change has been going on all the time, you know, and why do we have to, we realize that, and everybody agrees pretty much. But the one about the source of carbon dioxide, well, a lot of it can come from these eruptions, as you can see up at the top up there, Earth's biggest eruptions. This goes way back in time. That's 2.4 billion years and on down to 17 million years ago, all of them numbered. Some of these eruptions took place over many, many, many years, okay? And so one of the major constituencies of the material that comes out of a volcano is carbon dioxide. And so it can fluctuate a bit. And of course, as the continents are ground up by the movement of tectonic plates and so forth, the CO2 gets captured, you see, and puts place back in rock. We have a problem with trying to envision so much in terms of the deep time. It's just not something we're accustomed to because we, well, honestly, we don't live that long. And anyway, This is a, and this is another thing you don't really hear a whole lot about, the Milankovitch cycles. And what it, these things, these the variations of Earth's orbit and tilt and wobble influence the solar radiation that, and thus the heat gain or loss on the planet. And the orbit of the sun around the Earth is, it goes from a more, and well, you can see here what they've tried to be. It never has, so far as I know, well, I'm not sure what I can say, well, so far as I know anyway, there's been a circle, but it it varies from time to time. And you can see here that, too, these the tilt goes in a cycle of about 41,000 years and so on. But these movements work in concert to influence the climate, as well as CO2 concentration. And this being more recent here now, we can see that the temperature there is sort of in a brown, and carbon dioxide, which we've seen is going up in more recent times, and continues to do so. And I just put a little explanation about this Climate Central. It's an independent organization that is not government, but rather is, I guess you might say, a nonprofit that has a pretty good reputation. Of course, they got a website, and if you want to look into what they do, of course, it's there available to you. Another thing that's related to concentration of CO2, believe it or not, is economic activity. Right here, as you can see in that 2018 estimate there, well, we had a tax cut, you see, and more folks bought more SUVs and pickup trucks and so on. And so the estimate is that we had an increase in CO2, which kind of got us off of the curve that we're trying to work with to get down to where we need to be under the, well, ultimately the Paris Agreement, which we'll have a little bit more to say about as we go forward. But it kind of jumps around a bit based in part on economic activity and what we do regards of use of clearing forests for lumber and so forth. Some social and political observations. We have, I'll get to these, well, what was this, in the interest of time, I'll just start over on the upper left-hand side, the carbon tax, and I moved to a word fee. A lot of folks have started off their proposals with the term tax, and of course that's a little distasteful, hard to sell to the population. So some of them are calling it fee on CO2 emitted. And in that particular case, that is in the case of a carbon fee, the cost is known, that is, the fee, and the emissions are less certain. You don't really know what happens to the fossil fuels, for example, or the potential fossil fuels when they come out of the wellhead or come into a port of entry. And then if you move to cap and trade, it caps greenhouse gases and issues emissions permits known as certificates, which are traded. That is, if you're more conservative with your activities, you're able to save some of your emissions, and you have excess, we call them, certificates which you can trade in a marketplace. And the emissions are, in this particular model, are known, and the market price of the certificates is less certain. These are the two most popular ways that economists point to try to do something about cutting down on the use of fossil fuels. And fossil fuels is a main problem that we've got insofar as emissions that we might have control over. Anyway, down at the bottom of the key here, you see the dark blue carbon tax is being employed there, and you notice that Boulder, Colorado has already stepped out and taken a shot at it. Pending carbon tax that is kind of proposed and so forth in the sort of light blue cap and trade. California is separate from these up in the Northwest. These states here are doing the cap and trade, something called REGI. It's a group of states. New Jersey was part of it, but former Governor Chris Christie pulled New Jersey out of the operation. And so it's into other activities now. The pending cap and trade is in a lighter kind of orchid looking color, I guess you might say. The rest of the country is not doing much with this whole business of either carbon tax or fee or cap and trade. But you're going to hear more about it. And in fact, there's at least one bill that I know of that's been introduced in this current Congress since they came in this month? Let me back up, though. Because this is kind of useful to both the carbon fee and cap and trade are designed to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by raising prices and promote conservation. And that's, after all, is what we're after, you see. An issue that we have there, in addition to the higher fossil fuel prices, people don't want to pay higher prices for gas, you see, as I'm sure. I don't either. But what do we do with the revenue that's generated from these potential models over on the left? And the dividend to consumers is probably one that's, I know it's one that a couple of proposals are. The Republicans have a proposal, not in the legislature necessarily, but James Baker, former Secretary of State, and George Shultz, former just about everything in the government, it seems. He's got an impressive resume, for sure. And I guess Baker does, too, of course, but I just happened to stumble across Shultz's not too long ago. And or would you spend it on the infrastructure, or would you spend it on something like conservation programs, or you could add to that list going down? What you going to do with the revenue? And if you can, one of the reasons that it's so attractive to come forth with a dividend, let's see, that'd be going to the voters. And so voters would probably like that. Okay, let's move along then. This is just kind of a similar map to what we just saw in terms of the states that are involved. Up at the top, you see that it's carbon prices in pricing in the states, carbon pricing initiatives. The green is, there's a key up there, sort of at the top. That's current, it's green. And then the light green is under consideration, thinking about it, and then no policy. And that's us and just about everybody else, pretty much. But they tried to link it to these states here in terms of percentage of the population. No policy is 66% and so forth. So we got a ways to go, you see. And this is something that I picked up on something out of the Washington Post newsletter called Power Post. It comes over the internet daily. And, you know, you can see in the yellow up there, climate change seems barely a blip at all in the campaign messaging for candidates for the House and Senate. This had to do with the election season we had just last year. And this, some folks are indicating it's a reflection of the issues of perpetual low ranking among voters, even Democratic voters. And I might add, if you reflect back on the presidential debates, the most recent time, there just wasn't any talk about climate change or fossil fuels or whatever. It was just, And some of us tried to encourage the networks, the people who were sponsoring the debates, to at least ask one question. Didn't work. So that's one of the big problems we've got. And I think one of the reasons we don't talk about it, first of all, it's pretty complicated, all that stuff going back in deep time and the concentration of this, that, and the other. People just say, it's just too complicated. That's one thing. And then two, we've changed it into a political issue rather than a, shall we say, just solely environmental issue. Most of us know that Richard Nixon signed most of the major or earlier versions of the major federal laws regards the environment. You know, starting the Environmental Protection Agency, for example, Clean Water Act, and so forth. Back then, it just wasn't the same in terms of being a political issue. There were politics, of course, but it's now it's just gotten so rigid until we don't talk about it, even around in a family, you see, sometimes it seems. Well, anyway, moving ahead, this is just polling, as you can see there, and fairly recent, December 4 on the top bar there, and back in 15 for the bottom one there. The question asked was, which comes close to your view, even if none are exactly right. The climate change is caused by human activity, and the next group, 30% over here, is a natural phenomenon, and 4% say it's not happening, and then I don't know an old opinion. And you can see, though, that it's the over time, we've had a change, and other polls kind of show a similar sort of a result. So it's gradually moving, okay? And that's a good sign. It's just that it needs to move faster. Some of us feel very strongly. This is out of the same group, same time frame. It's actually a poll conducted in 18, and almost 2,000 people, concentrating on the first bar up there, all voters. 42% say yes, 18% I don't know, or no opinion, and 40% say no. This 40% right here, if we could somehow move them over here, we'd get some movement in the Congress, I believe. And that's the reason that, one of the reasons I'm here today. We need as citizens to get interested in this thing and start talking about it. And I've got to have more to say about that, so brace yourself. The energy scene. This is a pretty busy kind of a slide coming out of the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory, federal government, of course. Down the left-hand side there, you see the various kinds of, shall we say, sources of energy, oil at the bottom, and so on, working up through the whole group. Don't pay attention to all these little numbers in the middle. That's something we don't need to bother with. Pay attention to the colors of the lines and where they're headed and how wide they are, okay? And the electricity, as you can see up in that kind of a tan, it there comes coal and natural gas and a good bit of nuclear and so forth, and that's generating electricity, and it goes over to residential, commercial, and industrial. And so it's a pretty good chunk of the energy that we consumed in 17, it says up the top, you see. And natural gas then, moving on down a little bit, is a biggie. And not only in electricity generating, but other activities like heating homes and heating buildings and other activities. And then industrial processes use it. You know, you use methane, which is a major constituent of natural gas. You use it to make, for example, fertilizer, commercial fertilizer. And down here, petroleum, big, big part of it goes into transportation. So let's look over here just for a moment at these two boxes. Energy services. This is what productive energy, you might say. Notice the choice of terms here. Rejected energy. They're synonymous with wasted, okay? And so if we could, there's a lot of opportunities, you see, in trying to improve the situation by better techniques. But as you well know, the more you try to squeeze something down and make it more efficient, the more it costs to get it done. And so that's one of the drawbacks we have. But anyway, excuse me, you do see that there are certainly some opportunities. And there's a regards petroleum use, for example, and I just see here that transportation takes up a good bit of the petroleum, well, most of it, it seems. And right now, we're trying to freeze the efficiency of trajectory of the rule that was put forth in EPA in the previous administration. By freeze, I mean just don't let it advance and keep it less efficient insofar as the use of fuel. And you could say similar things about the Clean Power Plan having to do with the generation of electricity. Well, let's move along. We have spent a lot of money and time doing drilling and mining and so on for fossil fuels and other things as well, of course. This, as you can see probably, is Louisiana up here, and all this spiderweb business down here and the dots, that's offshore. Oil platforms, you see there's a key right there, a dot with a circle around it, offshore platform. And all these little lines, they're pipelines, okay? Now, they don't show the canals, it seems to me. Port Arthur, you see, is on the coast and so forth. And they don't see many other towns that are named right there. But nevertheless, what I'm driving at is, even back all along the coast, they've been channeling to be able to service the wells and all that on shore. And Louisiana's paid a real heavy price for supplying so much energy to the nation. And I guess, you know, they have had jobs and so forth, but they're losing land along the coast due to subsidence, erosion, and and sea level rise as well. And it's really significant. There's one town, the name of which I can't call right now, but it's already had to be moved. It's underwater where it was, or much of it had been. Well, anyway, well, let me back up just a little bit. You can see the location of the Deepwater Horizon in 2010. And this Taylor Energy Company oil platform just to the northwest of that Deepwater Horizon. That was in about 2004, and ever since that time, 300 to 700 barrels a day have been leaking into the Gulf because a hurricane blew over this or sank a platform down there in 2004, and there was a landslide, and they can't really cap it very readily, and it's just there creating a mess. Again, if we want the oil and all, we pay a price, though, for these kinds of things, and of course we know more about what happens with the Taylor Energy oil platform, the Deepwater one, and because it was in the news for, seemed like, endless time. And then we have mountaintop removal for primarily coal. This happening mostly in Appalachia. Back in the George Bush era, there was a great discussion about whether or not we're going to call this stuff that's been dumped over the side, if we're going to call it waste or something else, you see. If it's waste, it was going to be have to be hauled away. Well, they argued over it and finally just came to the conclusion, well, we'll just dump it down and bury the creeks. And so that's what you get with mountaintop removal. Most folks don't think it's a very good thing to do. Well, I don't know if I ought to say that. A lot of folks don't think it's a good thing to do. But anyway, again, it's a matter of needing energy and resources. And this one is something you don't see much in the way of pictures of, but I dug this out of something called mining. And this is, as you can see, tar sands in Alberta, Canada. These little specks that you see down here are some of the equipment that they use to do the job. And all this in the background is forest. All this was forest. And it's the tar sands are pretty shallow, but they haul it away, and it's all mixed with sand, as indicated. And the quality of the material that sand is that's mixed with it, that is the petroleum product, is it takes a lot of work to get it into gasoline, okay, and it's kind of costly. And the size of the equipment that they use all over through the fossil fuel industries, it seems to me, is just huge. Here's one example, a really big truck. Here's a guy standing in front of the left front tire, and he comes up about to the center of it, you see. And I don't know if you can read the bottom here, 400 tons of ore in one trip. Big gas tank, and uses a lot of fuel. And these things are still around, and there's a lot of them. And I don't know if you've ever seen these oil platforms that they haul out into the Gulf with tugboats. They are humongous. And they cost a arm and a leg, you see. But this sort of thing is, it's expensive kind of activity, of course. But everybody wants the lights to be turned on and the car to move. And so here we go. We've heard a lot, I'm sure, about fracturing to get oil and gas. It's often referred to as fracking for short. But you can see here that it's just a diagram. It's the way it kind of works. Some of you might be pretty familiar with it. Up at the top it says tanker trucks line up to deliver the water. It takes a lot of water to do this fracking, okay? And they put it into the ground with these so-called pumper trucks, which is depicted right here. These are little explosive charges that they go off to make the fractures in the shale, ordinarily. They call them fissures, you see. And the sand that they mix with the water, and then there's some proprietary chemicals that they use that they don't like to talk about what they are. And the sand helps to prop open the little channels in the fissures. So the oil in this case, in this picture they're talking about, but the same, similar, very similar kind of operation works with gas, natural gas, you know. As you can see, there are storage tanks for oil and discarded fractured fluid up here at this point right here. Oil is trucked out for delivery, or pipelines, it's to a pipeline facility to put it into the system, you might say. And in the Permian Basin right now in West Texas, they don't know what to do with all this excess of what is now, after it comes out of the well, after it's fractured, you might say. They don't know what to do with it because it's polluted. So they're building, scrambling to try to build pipelines to pipe it away from the Permian Basin, West Texas. Permian Basin's been producing oil and gas for a long time, But see, this fracturing thing has come on in the last, several years, 10 years or so. And it's just raised the bar in regards to production. They go back and rework the fields that they kind of gave up on, you see. Okay, got to move. This has to do with the capacity of generation of electricity for coal-fired power plants. Well, you can see up at the top what it's all about. But retirement of these things. This is not individual plants. It's the capacity, and some of the plants are bigger than others and so forth. But anyway, the message is, in this particular slide, is that we're offloading, you might say, or closing down coal-fired power plant capacity. And it's been suggested that if we keep on going the rate we're going, we will have closed them all in not too distant period of time, not very long. And a lot of people have been working on it. But now, something kind of brighter here. Some of you, maybe all of you, are aware that in Chambers County, right now, we're producing, the folks who run this solar farm, you might say, up in near Fayette, not Lafayette, it's, as pointed out here, in Chambers County, the Alabama Power unit requested by Walmart. I don't have that. I can't document that necessarily, but I do know that Walmart has made a business decision to go to renewable energy worldwide in their operation, and they have a lot of stores, thousands of them. And this particular arrangement right here is part of trying to provide renewable energy for Walmart's operation throughout the state of Alabama. And it's now functioning. They got Public Service Commission of Alabama to approve the arrangement, and so they made the contract to put this facility in, and it's producing electricity right now. And by the way, as you probably will recall, we've had solar power on the top of the Justice Center between here, well, it's in Opelika, I guess, for years. So it's not really necessarily new to Alabama, but we'll have more to say about that. Okay, and then two windmills are beginning to sprout up. We don't have them in Alabama, of course. There are two or three reasons. We don't have enough wind, steady wind, and we also have hurricanes. And you put it together with what has been, quite frankly, a political climate that's not really, how should I put it, not particularly interested in renewable energy. So we don't, that's another reason. But major reasons are the first two I just cited, I think. Because if you don't have wind, no use to put up a windmill. Okay. But they're around all over, and they're getting ready to be offshore. Well, there's one, at least one up east already operational in recent times. People don't want to look at them. You know, it messes up the viewscape, they call it. And but we got to have energy. I enjoy cooking with electricity and whatever, and I'm sure you do too. Let's move along. United States carbon dioxide emissions by source. This being a chart from Oxford Humanist Educational Association. And it seems to fit with some of the other things I've run into. But we won't try to get at all of these little slices of the pie. But notice, if you will, the electricity right out here in the upper right-hand corner, 38% is of the carbon dioxide emissions comes from fossil fuels and electricity generation. And then look down here, transportation. So these are kind of the two biggies. And of course, these others are not insignificant, but and there's room, I'm sure, for improvement. These are some of the things that, particularly transportation and electricity generation, that we've tried to work on, you see. Stern talk by scientists, and there has been a lot of it. You may recall seeing, there's a fellow named James Hansen from Iowa. He studied under Van Allen, the fellow who discovered the Van Allen belts around the Earth that kind of help protect us from the radiation, cosmic radiation. He started Stern Talk 30 years ago, testifying before the Congress. Nobody much listened. Let's go ahead and see what they're saying now. All these three slides I'm getting ready to show you, this is late 2018, okay? And this is what the experts are saying. Notice the top in the yellow. This having to do with the Arctic now. Surface air temperature in the Arctic continued to warm at twice the rate relative to the rest of the globe. And then moving on down, atmospheric warming continued to drive broad long-term trends in declining snow cover on the ground, the Greenland ice sheet, and the lake ice up in the north, and also this then all moved toward the rivers and increased the river discharge in the summertime. In other words, the ice is melting, right? Incidentally, I might just point out here that Greenland is a little bit larger than Mexico in terms of land area. And it's probably somewhere in the neighborhood of 80% covered by ice. And there's a lot of ice there because, you know, Mexico is not just a smallish little place. And neither is Greenland, a little bit bigger. If you go to a map, and I'm going to have to defer to Sonny right here, I believe it's called Mercator Projections for maps. Well, Greenland looks like a huge thing up at the top, looks like Australia or something. Well, it's just an artifact of the way the maps are drawn, okay? Greenland is not as big as it looks on a lot of maps, but it's big and got a lot of ice on it. And it's melting along with us. Okay, let's push here. In 18, that last section there that's in yellow, in 18, the sea ice remained younger, thinner, and covered less of an area in the past. And the 12 lowest extents of satellite record have occurred in the last 12 years. This is sea ice now. When sea ice melts, it doesn't raise the sea level, as you know. You know, when the ice melts in a glass of iced tea, it doesn't cause a thing to overflow for sure. But the land ice is what we're really concerned about when it comes to sea level rise. And I haven't mentioned anything about it, but coupled with the melting of the ice, the heating of the oceans causes it to expand. Okay, and that is a significant part of this whole thing of sea level rise. Okay, moving right along. The fourth National Climate Assessment continues to inform and urge action. There's been, as you can see here, this came from an act that was passed back in 1990. And this fourth report, released in November of last year, focuses on climate impact risks and adaptations occurring in the U.S. Present tense, it's happening now. It's not out yonder somewhere. And if we, as I'm sure you follow the news, and it's it's evident that things are indeed happening, and I'll have a little bit more to say about that as we go forward in a few moments. And this is just the first of nine key findings down here at the bottom. Human health and safety, our quality of life, and the rate of economic growth in communities across the U.S. are increasingly vulnerable to impacts of climate change, period. So it's kind of, you know, sobering. And then the UN has something called the COP, Conference of Parties. And then that one has a 24 after it. That means it's the 24th annual meeting. We've been talking about this thing for a while. Here we have under the Paris Agreement, which, you know, it came forth in 15, countries got to set a goal what they're going to do about the greenhouse gas emissions. And then they have to report on this, and the time frame is every 5 years. The agreement was designed to ratchet up emission cuts, or cut them down, if you want to put it that way, over time. And in this most recent meeting in Poland, last month, you can see they created some standards in reporting emissions, and the agreement also includes transparency guidelines so that countries can verify all the progress. So you're going to kind of embarrass the folks who are sort of slacking off, you see. But they're going to supposedly have to follow some standard rules in trying to get at how much emissions they have, which it seems to me like that. Hello? Well, I guess it's okay. It wasn't a fire alarm anyway, I guess. Okay, some results of climate change. Maybe it was telling me it's time to turn to the next slide. Or the next section. Some results. Well, we've already kind of looked a little bit at this, but this is slightly different. As you can see, this runs from it's annually, February through December, anyway. Well, January through December, if you can start back at the far left side in the corner. And this is a number on the left-hand side. It's a number of these events, and they don't really say what they are, hurricanes, tornadoes, whatever. But you'll notice that they're kind of bunched up here. There's some recent years, and this is the average over all of the years that they included in the study. And I just added down here what Climate Central is, and I've already kind of addressed that a little bit earlier. I don't own any stock in Climate Central. In fact, I don't think they have stock to sell, but nevertheless, it is a fairly respected independent agency that you can consult if you wish. Now, here's another view of some of the disasters this having to do with last calendar year. I won't try to get into all of the little circles and what they were, but it represents, as you can see in the title up there, 2018's billion-dollar weather and climate disasters. And you can get this kind of a depiction for each of the, certainly for several years in the recent past. I just put this latest one in the interest of time. But you remember surely Hurricane Michael. Just devastated an area of Florida that hadn't really been hit for a while. Mexico City, I believe, something like that. I never have been down there to look at it since the damage and all. And then Hurricane Florence, I'll have another little slide on that just momentarily, was devastating. North Carolina's been hit probably, if you include Michael, it's been hit three times in the last 2 years, a little over 2 years. And so they kind of believe in more in climate change over there. It's gotten their attention. And This is just an indication of, as you can see at the top, economic toll of hurricanes since 1871. And it just shows you, this is in 2017 dollars, incidentally, it's converted to make it kind of standardized. And of course, there's some wiggle room in those numbers, I'm sure, but the trend is pretty obvious there. It's in billions of dollars, and it's getting worse over time. So we're paying for a lot of this in taxes, you know. And this is just the hurricanes. And, you know, we got the fires and the droughts and all the other things I have to contend with. Here's another slide on Florence, extreme rainfall. And you can see that down in the southern part of the state, or southeast part of the state, they really got hit pretty badly. And one other thing, too. They've got coal ash pits around the state, just like every state does. But another thing that they have abundance of in southeast North Carolina is massive hog farms. And they have these so-called lagoons. I prefer to call them cesspits. There's a lot of waste and a lot of odor and a lot of stuff you don't want to be back, close by. But I will point out at this now, since that hurricane hit, I saw something that Smithfield, which is big time producer of hog products, meats and, you know, ham and bacon and all the rest of it, they decided they're going to cap the lagoons, I'll use that term. And they're going to start capturing the methane off of it and selling it, which makes sense. At least let's get something out of it rather than polluting the air all around. And methane is a big-time greenhouse gas, major. It's right up there with carbon dioxide. It degrades into carbon dioxide, I believe, and so it hangs around, the two of them together. But anyway, we're making a little progress, okay. We're capturing methane in southeast part of North Carolina. They really got hammered. Okay, now this is a barrier island. As you can see, Hurricane Florence's winds are category one strength. You know, it wasn't that strong compared to some others. One in particular, I'm gonna show you in just a minute. 30 inches of rain in some areas. And this is Topsail Beach right here, shown before Florence. The first two rows of the structures on the seaward side over here were pretty much wiped out. You couldn't live in them anymore after the hurricane hit. Of course, that's not surprising. I mean, we've seen pictures like that forever. Well, maybe not forever, but for a long, long time. And living by the ocean is nice, it's pretty, and people enjoy it a lot. I do myself, albeit I must confess I prefer the mountains. And it's usually cooler. Anyway, but here you get into getting too far ahead. You get into trouble when you build right on the water, particularly where the wind blows hard and rain comes down big time. Okay, well, this is a big hurricane I wanted to mention to you. As you can see here, it's a typhoon, which is what they call them in the Pacific. And the hurricanes in the Atlantic and in the Pacific, typhoons. And in the Indian Ocean, they call them cyclones. Same kind of stuff, but on a different name. And this is, as you can see, the Mariana Islands. And it's territory of the U.S., and it really got after that part of the world. It was a huge hurricane, and it was, some of you who recall, well, I suspect a lot of folks in here recall parts of World War II, Saipan, Tinian, I remember those, Guam, and so forth, from back in the Battle of the South Pacific you know, or battles, plural. Anyway, escalating pace of ice loss in Antarctica. It's, as I said before, it's going up, and well, we ought to be trying to do something about it. And indeed, we are. It's just that we are not moving fast enough. I'll say a little bit more about that later. Mali is one of the that's the capital that's been pictured there, of the Republic of the Maldives. It's off of the, as you can see there, the southern tip of India. Small, relatively small little island. It's packed with people and things, and it's about 4 feet above sea level. I guess you won't run out of breath going to the highest point, about 8 feet. And there are other islands, of course, in the little nation. It's an island nation. And this is not the only one, as you probably know. The South Pacific has two or three others that are under threat because of sea level rise. Okay, that's about all I need to say about that. And here's blue-green algae, cyanobacteria. That's largely associated with such as higher water temperatures brought on by climate change, and also farming practices where we may be over-fertilized, we get runoff into lakes, rivers, creeks, whatever, and it causes these kinds of developments here. Blue-green algae in this case. And you've heard of red tide, of course. I've experienced that on the Gulf temporarily. I've been down there, and it's kind of tough. You could be back off the beach, and if the wind's blowing good, your eyes start burning and all. So anyway, that sort of thing is kind of upsets the ecosystems in the water and so forth. So climate change is forcing the insurance industry to recalculate. And this from the Wall Street Journal. Insurers are at the vanguard of the movement to put a value today on unpredictable future of a warming planet. Some of the big reinsurance companies like Swiss Re or Swiss Ra, I guess it's Swiss Re, they provide a backup funds for regular insurance companies that we deal with as customers. And they've been into studying this sort of thing for a long time because they know that they're at risk if they make some mistakes, and they got to get it right. But this was just last year, as you can see right there from the Wall Street Journal. Some developments in renewable energy, and I've been going a while here, so I've got to hurry. We got just a brief introduction to some of the jobs that have been going on around the country, or the numbers of jobs concerning renewable energy. 3.2 million of clean energy jobs in America. And I won't go to get into these various states, but these are some of the more prominent ones. They didn't mention Iowa. Maybe they didn't have quite enough. But, you know, Iowa's got, they got windmills all over the place up there. And the farmers just love it, because particularly if they're into a center pivot irrigation outfit, I don't know if they have as many as some farther to the west. But anyway, you can lease some land if you got a center pivot. You can't get out to all of the, in a square plot, to, you know, it won't get the corners. Well, you can put a windmill up on it, though, and draw a check every month. They like that. So anyway, and this is kind of something sort of similar here. Amount of solar power generated. This is solar power now, generated in the residential sector by photovoltaic solar panels. And you can see that it's in the southwest. This is where a lot of the really intense sunshine is available. Very few rain clouds. It doesn't rain much out there. And notice, though, that particularly starting with Alabama and going all the way up there to the North Dakota and over into Wyoming a bit. There's West Virginia as well. There's not much going on with solar power. However, notice that light green Kentucky? The coal museum in the mountains of eastern Kentucky has just, in the interest of saving money, has put up solar panels. That's what I read. So it's, changes are coming, folks. Get ready. Be a part of it. Okay. This is just something when we get to the right-hand side in just a minute. Some folks at Stanford University decided to do some fancy math and all to try to find out, and using artificial intelligence as well, and algorithms and so forth, they decided where all the solar panels are. Now, it's erroneous to say that California is one big solar panel, but it does give you some indication of the concentration of solar panels, and it's useful for utility companies to make plans and installers to where they might find some business, and lawmakers to incentivize adoption of the renewables. And so there's spaces and for a lot of things to happen. I just thought that was kind of interesting that people are trying to really locate all the solar panels, and it's a good thing to do, of course, to know where they are, so you can add some more, too. Now, these are mostly projections here regards storage, batteries, that sort of thing. But it is good to point out that there are improvements to batteries, and we need that sort of thing. And if we got all this energy that's generated by the wind, and also the sunshine, we need some way to store it. So over time, we anticipate batteries to become more prominent. Walmart, again, shows up here in that they are putting up a charging station in 36 states. And it just shows you that Walmart in particular and several other big companies, the big box retailers are, several of them are into this sort of thing. But I just have this one slide here. Duke Energy is, because of state law, is providing monies or rebates for people to put up solar panels, solar rebates. They were gone in 2 days. It's the second year in 5 years, $62 million program required by state law. We don't have it in Alabama, in case you're wondering. Opportunities in Alabama. I'll be quick here. We have a lot of opportunities, but we haven't really addressed the opportunity, or maybe even recognized them. This is a study that was released in 17, and it's the big box retailers, they call themselves the Retail Industry Leaders Association. Some of the big fellows, we got them here in town. And they say that in this study that Alabama's cumulative score was 1.82 compared to the winner at 15.56, which is Alaska. And this group says that they're having trouble with Alabama because it's the most difficult state in the country to meet the goals that they have. Why Alabama lags the rest of the Southeast on solar power. A unique combination of policy obstacles, burdensome fees, and one reluctant utility company has Alabama lagging behind. Well, we all know who the utility company is. But let me just say that the Southern Company CEO, beginning early last year, made two or three public announcements that I'm aware of, saying that by 2050, the Southern Company is going to be at zero or very low carbon emissions. And, of course, that's talk is easy, you see, but Most of these big companies, regardless of what they're doing, and of course, power generation is under the gun all across the country. They got to change their business model. But Alabama Power, being wholly owned subsidiary of the Southern Company, they will, in fact, I'm sure, get on board. Well, they already are to some extent, I'm one of the ones who like to push them a little faster. Here's some things that we haven't got in Alabama. Quick facts on distributed solar power generation in Alabama. Solar power generation in Alabama. And notice this is a little bit dated right here, 16. Somebody from the Center of Biological Diversity. Anyway, these are kind of some technical sort of things that we don't really have. Reason we don't have them is because we don't have a legal structure to accommodate them or require them. So I have just a wee bit more to say about that on this slide. These are some similar kinds of categories right here. But please note that this outfit that put this slide together, Solar Power Rocks, they in the solar panel business. So they'd kind of want to push it a bit, you see. But nevertheless, they kind of drew it all together in one slide, and there we are right there with a lot of red blocks and red blocks over here corresponding, such things as tax credits and rebates and sales tax exemptions and so forth. We don't have that insofar as a solar panel report card. Now, this is a 2017 year report, but there hadn't been a change in 2018, but they don't have a 2018 slide that combines it all. They've got all of them separated out into separate slides, all these little Fs here. So I just decided to use this 2017 to kind of pull it all together. But again, these folks have a bias, and we need to recognize that. But they do have some good things on their website. Solar Power Rocks, if you're interested in knowing more about it, that's one place to go and look. Okay, and I'm getting near the end, folks. As you can see here, two yellow marked statements, a percentage of a state's electricity and solar point to 26%. Prices have fallen 43% in the last 5 years. This from the Solar Energy Industries Association. That's what that SEIA stands for. It's a trade association. But this is data of the third quarter of last year. So we are doing some things, but we need to do more. What's new in 19? Well, we've got a lot of things going for us, and if you could look at this second one here, this coming again now from Solar Power Rocks. The state legislature has done very little to encourage solar power development. I don't know of a corresponding anything that's going on in Montgomery in regard to solar power and the rest of it. That's really about the next last slide right here. And I would implore you to be vocal about this sort of thing. You have an interest in it. If you didn't have an interest in it, you wouldn't be here, I would think. And I just feel like that we need to let our elected representatives know how we feel about things. And as you can see from some of the early slides in this, it's just folly to say it's not happening or it's not caused by us. We just need to get busy and try to make some changes. And we need to, I believe we're going to have some sort of a thing like a carbon fee or also a cap and trade, one of those two, maybe both of them. In some jurisdictions, it just doesn't seem to me that we'd want to ration, let's say, gasoline like we did during World War II. I remember we had an A sticker on our car, which means you didn't drive much. Okay, so that's it. Now, if we might...